Perhaps no other sport is as uniquely defined by individuals as NASCAR. For every driver's action, there's a reaction. From the track, to the sponsors, to the fans. They're players in a high-speed drama, and they've been called everything from vanilla to villain. And yet the fearlessness which characterizes their driving also carries over to their conversation. So here they are, candid and unabashed, four of NASCAR's biggest stars to face.
I've always worn my emotions on my shoulder. I don't have much of a filter, and I'm all right with that. I want to win eight.
2006. The second year is fourth five-time champion.
I need to put that mark way out there and give me something to chase.
I don't expect everybody to like me.
Kyle Busch is an ass.
I just hope they don't hate me.
My father was one of the best in the business. I just knew it was going to be tough to really sell people on me.
From the chaos and intensity of a racetrack to an art gallery, Jimmie Johnson is equally at home. Work or play, racing or family, he has an uncommon ability to shift focus, something that resulted in five straight Cup championships. On display here, and in a book entitled On the Road, is his quest for a sixth during the 2011 chase, with wife Shani and daughter Evie in tow. It's kind of a funky area of Charlotte here. Art museum?
Yeah, a little different. We're in Charlotte, technically. Great gallery here. We've put a bunch of images in here from our book On the Road, and then also some other images that we shot last year during the chase. And Shani had this amazing vision of the book and the gallery, and here's the gallery.
The photographer took, I think, over 15,000 images.
Wow.
You know, we really wanted to focus on powerful images, certainly telling a story of what went on over the chase last year, but more photo-driven and image-driven than really storytelling.
And Jimmie had one task, and that was to name all the photographs for the exhibit. So
I was stuck on bend over at first, and she found that inappropriate, so I went to the second option was baby mama.
I'm like, oh, baby even mama. Better.
That's really nice.
Yes. I'm like, great.
I'm assuming that when you're with Jimmie, you have to learn to have a sense of humor.
Oh, totally.
Well, and my sense of humor,
so
I'm not
funny.
Sure.
I'm like, well, at least this is not so serious. I mean, it is an exhibit, but we are still having fun.
Jimmie Johnson goes to the top of the stack at Kansas, scores his second win of the season.
What do you remember about that moment?
That was near the midway point of the chase. Feelings were strong and good, and we thought we could keep the streak alive at that point. And ironically, there's a section of crash photos. The next race at Charlotte had a big wreck.
Jimmie Johnson, sideways!
Could be the turning point of the chase for the 48 man.
Went from the highs of highs here in Kansas to the start of it all coming to an end.
That's what you called the emotional roller coaster of the chase, right? And that's sort of what you wanted to portray here.
I did. I mean, we knew if I won the championship and kept the streak alive, there would be an amazing story. And then if I lost, the same thing would be there. So it's just part of it. I mean, my streak came to an end. I hate that it did, but it's life and you can't win everything. We try.
How tough was that?
As we started to lose our grip on the championship, when I look back on it, I don't like the mental approach I had, the attitude I had, the way I interacted with the race team.
Sounds real f***ing encouraging. Come on, dude.
Dude, your cheerleading's terrible. I'm going to drive my ass off. Don't sweat it. Just f***ing watch.
Prove it, baby. Come on.
Actually annoying instead of helping. Just let me go out and do my f***ing thing.
There was some vulnerability at that point. I think he felt like he was losing a little bit of control. He just seemed so in control the years past. And I think this year he seems so much more even keel.
I think the way in which we lost it was hard on me, and it's made me a better man, better racer today. I learn more from those tough moments, and I think everybody does.
So where are you taking me to here?
It's Cabo Fish Taco, one of our Mexican stops to fill my fix. I grew up in Southern California, and I need a fish taco and a cold beer from time to time.
Jimmy grew up in El Cajon, California, a community in the hills outside San Diego. He lived in a trailer home. His mom was a school bus driver. His dad, a heavy equipment operator. From these meager beginnings came an unlikely racing career.
For me, my early years, it was all about motorcycles and bicycles. We didn't have a nice home, we didn't have nice cars, but we had new dirt bikes and we'd travel the country racing. As a kid, as long as my grades were up and my homework was done, I could literally hop on my bike, fire it off, and ride a mile on some little back asphalt roads and be off on trails and ride out on all these great tracks.
How old were you when you were first on a bike?
Christmas when I was 4, I got my first bike. I started racing that next season, so I was 5. There's just these little teeny tykes on motorcycles, and the parents all stand in the corner because inevitably they tip over, so the bike tips over, and they stand them up and push them off, and they go off again. I miss California. It's a great spot. So now when I go back, it's fun to see home and my old school and all of those things, but I miss it. I'm so rooted now in North Carolina, but there still is a big part of me that's a SoCal guy.
Jimmy Johnson in his home state of California is headed to victory lane.
You are the man, Johnson. You are the man.
In 1996, Jimmy left California for Charlotte. He entered the NASCAR Cup Series full-time in 2002, driving a car owned by Rick Hendrick and Jeff Gordon.
I knew I had an amazing opportunity. Jeff Gordon had just won the championship the year before, and his entire fleet of cars was handed over to me to go racing with. So I was extremely excited, but then also knew there was a great deal of pressure coming, and if I didn't perform, I'm not sure I'd be around long.
When did you feel that you had really earned those opportunities?
I just kind of quietly sat back and was waiting to see where I would fit in. I'd say really championship 3 or 4, I felt like my voice deserved to be heard. I've always taken the kind of cautious route, and I think I was beat up on a little bit from the fans as a result, and they thought that I was maybe too vanilla at times, and rightfully so.
What is it that people have learned about you?
I mean, work hard, play hard. That's the way I was raised. I'm into sports, I'm into having fun, I'm into my friends, I'm into my family. I mean, absolutely, I'm gonna drink some beer and enjoy myself.
What's the dumbest thing you've ever done?
First thing that comes to mind is trying to surf the top of a golf cart.
A couple of broken wrists there, right?
Yeah, that was a broken wrist. The best 16 holes of golf that anyone has ever had, but then ended abruptly.
What'd you take away from that experience?
In the end, I'm gonna be a fool, I've always been. Yes, that's kind of an embarrassing thing that I'll have to tell my daughter someday that I did, so I'm not thrilled about that. But the media that followed it, I didn't understand why anybody cared that I broke my wrist after the season was over. And it actually frustrated me heavily to turn on ESPN and to see the ticker and news flash. I'm like, why? I don't get it. But now I get it.
In 2002, Jeff Gordon introduced Jimmy to Chandra Janway, who was working as a model in New York City. The couple married 2 years later, and in 2010 had a daughter named Genevieve.
How old was she when you first brought her on the road?
I think she was 2 months. I think.
Yeah, that's all right.
I think her first trip was, she's 2 months old.
And right here, I mean, she's actually right in the middle of the action.
She prefers that, especially pre-race. You can see, here we are in victory lane. She's wandering around. This is pre-race, the next image over. And she's so intrigued by the car and the uniforms and the chaos that she'll just wander around the car and check things out. I'll hop on a golf cart at a race, put her headphones on and drive to a corner and we'll watch the Nationwide Series or the Truck Series practice and just totally loves it.
What about you as a mom? Because, it's intense. Some people would say it can be kind of dangerous. Were you afraid at all at first about taking this little infant out there on the track?
Well, when she was an infant, yes. I think that was a little tricky. And now she's a little bigger and she kind of leads the way.
What's the pre-race ritual when you guys are on the road?
I'll go out prior to do the intros and meet them at the car, say my goodbye, get in the car and race. But it's not uncommon to be like, especially when she was smaller, in the sink of our bus, in my fire suit, helping bathe, getting her finished up as I hand her off to Shani. See you in a little bit, I gotta go to the car.
When does that switch flip? When you're dad and then you become Jimmy Johnson, the racer?
Really when we fire the engines. I've learned that, you know, once I strap in, put my helmet on, fire the engine, it's time to change gears and get into race mode.
Oh, here we go. Trouble, contact, and a huge crash. It looks like Dan Weldon may be involved in it.
We got to the racetrack and we're in the motorhome, and we were both drawn to the television watching it. And when we saw the image after, and how Genevieve picked up on our energy and was watching with the same eyes, she didn't know what she was looking at, but she could just sense it from us. It's a really powerful shot to us.
What's it like for you guys to see something like that happen, to be confronted with the frailty of what you do as a profession?
It was tough.
It's intense.
It's tough for me because I knew Dan, and then knowing the fact that he had a young family, it just became real to me in so many ways, and it really, really hit me.
And how do you handle that as a wife and a mother?
It definitely makes you think about it a little more when you have a family, but it's what he does and he loves it and we support him.
2006 NASCAR champion.
The second year in a row.
Three-peat, baby.
On his fourth consecutive.
Yeah! You're looking at the five-time champion.
When you look back on that incredible period from 2005 to 2010, nobody had won four straight, much less five. What is your overarching thought about that period of time?
Magical. It's crazy. It's mind-boggling. I'm very proud of what we've accomplished. I don't want to say it will never be done again, because if we did it, anybody can do it, but it went forever where someone won three straight, and that was Cale Yarborough in the 70s. So it's not going to happen easily, and I'm proud of that. You know, I like to leave a strong mark out there for somebody to go chase.
Have you set your sights on the all-time mark, becoming the all-time greatest with eight?
I have. I have a good friend that told me, limits begin where the vision ends. So with that in mind, I want to win eight. I need to set a big mark out there, because I don't want to limit myself. So, and I
You're
know
not afraid to say it.
I'm not. And I feel like it's different than, you know, calling a shot. I mean, it's a goal. I fully understand that it's a lofty one. And I don't know if it's possible to be done, but I have blown through every goal I've set for myself. My goal is to win a cup race. I have five championships. So I need to put that mark way out there and give me something to go chase.
Ahead on NASCAR Face to Face, the rising star, the fan favorite, and the bad boy. An up-close look at three of NASCAR's top drivers. Next, Brad Keselowski is gunning for number one.
I feel good. Now I'm ready to win the chase. I have no stress.
Everybody's in trouble now, man.
Don't look now. Brad Keselowski is on the move.
You don't get no better than this right here.
Here's Keselowski right now. Keselowski is gone.
No weakness, man. Hell yeah.
It is Brad Keselowski. He will win.
Woo! Brad Keselowski.
In just his third full season here at Penske Racing, Brad Keselowski is much more than an overnight sensation. The 28-year-old is a championship contender. Confident, outspoken, possessing an aggressive nature, which stems from survival instinct. Growing up as a third-generation racer in Michigan, Brad was born for this life.
What a remarkable run for the young man from Michigan.
Bring me the checker flag.
Yeah! Hell yeah!
How much was racing part of the fabric of your family life?
It was the fabric. I wouldn't say it was part of the fabric. It was the whole shirt. You know, it was the one thing that I could get out of the bed in the morning and feel inspired to want to be the best at.
The fans are on their feet here as Bob Keselowski takes the win.
Young Brad didn't have to look far for inspiration. His father, Bob, was not only the owner of the family's business, K Automotive Motorsports, but was also the team's driver in both the ARCA and Craftsman Truck Series.
I can recall times when my family had zero money because the racing was not going well at all. You know, I can remember times where we didn't have the heat turned on and things of that nature, and I just thought that was normal. I thought it was just cold, you know. But I look back at it, and quite honestly, I think how lucky I was, because it made me tougher, made me stronger, and made me appreciate the opportunities I have now.
What kind of jobs did you have growing up in the family business?
I seem to always get garbage detail. I'm not sure why. We had this dumpster. I can remember, you know, you'd put a box in and you'd stomp it down. I mean, stomping on dirty rags with grease and, you know, on race teams, there was always people that chewed and spit, so the garbage always had chew in it, and my shoes were covered in it. It was nasty.
You became a driver really at age 14. You moved from doing all those other jobs.
Yeah. Well, I still had to do the garbage detail. That never ended. Yeah. I'm a little traumatized by that. I don't know if you can tell.
In 2004, Brad finally graduated from garbage detail and began racing, just like his dad, in the Craftsman Truck Series for the family team.
My father went through some health issues at about that time, and my team's financial, or my family's company, I should say, their financial situation was not very good. You know, it became a matter of who was going to try and fix it, and I got the opportunity to do it. I would say, looking back now, that I failed, for sure.
What do you mean you failed?
It failed because we eventually just went bankrupt. Well, I was not successful as a driver, and as a team, we weren't successful. We just made bad decisions to not make it work.
The Kozlowskis had to suspend operations of their team in 2006. And the next year, the team Brad was driving for in the Nationwide Series suffered the same fate. But then he got a big break. A ride with Nationwide Series owner Dale Earnhardt Jr.
I would like to say that we're excited to announce that we're signing a 2-year deal with Brad Kozlowski as our driver.
What did he see in you?
Well, Dale at that time was looking for an answer to his race team and his company to be successful. He probably saw a hunger in me to do the same, you know, a common goal to make a name for myself and find a way to be successful.
First time winner, Brad Kozlowski.
It's awesome. This is it. This is what I've been dreaming of my whole life.
What do you feel you owe him?
I think I owe him to not take the opportunity that he gave me that no one else had to date and waste it.
Oh, no! He turns him! No! No!
And Junior's protege, Kozlowski, the winner.
Your first win, Sprint Cup level, 2009, Talladega. You made contact with Carl Edwards. He gets airborne.
I like how you said that, by the way. Made contact.
I was trying to be delicate. How should I have phrased it?
I think of racing, and this is a little bit of like Confucius, so just bear with me. I think of racing as though you're running through the woods. And if you stop, there's this guy chasing you that hits you with a baseball bat. He just hits you. And if you stop, every time you stop, he hits you with it. But the important thing to remember along the way is to not confuse running into a tree with being hit by the bat.
Meaning?
They're both made out of wood and they both hurt. One's your fault, one's not. And I would say, going back to that incident, that I didn't hit him with a bat, he ran into a tree.
You had a reputation for being involved in a lot of incidents.
Kyle Busch is an ass.
I treat you like the damn king, and you treat me like
Brad sticks his nose back in here again.
I make a lot of trees. I plant trees around my competitors. How about that?
I'll win the race. I'll just buy everybody around here.
You said you were bothered when people booed you.
It can be bothersome, yeah. Because you want to just sit down and have a beer with him and tell him, no, you don't understand. You know? You just don't get it, man. Let me help you.
If you could sit down and have a beer with somebody who was booing you, what would you say?
Well, first, I'd want to know why they booed me. And second, I'd want to explain to them why I made some of the decisions I made that might irk them, so they could maybe see it from my view. I don't expect everybody to like me. I just hope they don't hate me.
Brad Kozlowski racing one-legged this afternoon.
You're at Road Atlanta, and during testing, you fracture your ankle, and you make a decision to go ahead and race 4 days later at Pocono. Why?
I didn't feel good at all about where I was at Penske Racing. At that time, quite candidly, I had talked about doing something different the next year.
You were really second-guessing yourself?
Oh, absolutely. We had zero success, in my opinion, at that time at the cup level.
The story of this one is going to be the young man who came back from a terrible crash and has gutted out a win at Pocono Raceway.
I gave it all, man. I
glad you guys could be rewarded for everything you're doing.
By going out there and finding a way to be successful despite the injury, we all looked at each other and for the first time saw a team. And since then, we've been incredible.
Don't look now. Brad Keselowski is on the move. Brad Keselowski gets the victory.
Right now, Keselowski is gone.
Yeah!
How about Brad Keselowski and this Penske Racing team finding a way to pull off a win?
In 2010, Keselowski won the Nationwide Series Championship. That same year, he joined Penske Racing full-time on the Cup level. Now, Brad's looking to give team owner Roger Penske his first NASCAR Sprint Cup Championship.
He said it would be the biggest mountain he's ever climbed to win a NASCAR title. For him to say that's the biggest mountain he would have ever climbed is a testament to how hard it is to win a NASCAR.
This is the iconic number two Miller Lite. This is the Blue Deuce. What was it like when you got this ride?
Well, I remember almost feeling a bit ashamed, like I wasn't worthy, you know?
You had to live up to this.
Rusty and Kurt and Bobby Allison, all drivers that have won for Miller, beyond that legacy, of all the drivers that have drove it and have won races and championships, none of them have done it in this car. So I want to be that first guy.
Today he will win and make another huge statement about his intent in this year's championship run.
I just saw something on the wall over here. This is, it's like the ultimate fat head. Look at you.
Are you saying I have a fat head?
What is it like to walk into the garage and see that every day?
It's humbling and terrifying at the same time. I'm just not really comfortable seeing pictures of myself. I think they made me look about 3 years younger, which seems like it should be impossible to do, but they found a way.
Oh, what's that?
That's telling me to use the brakes. Okay. I don't listen to that. This new technology
funny.
In street cars does not get along with me very well.
It tries not to tell style.
Me. It tries to tell me how to drive. I know how to drive, damn it. Tell me what to do.
Now you keep a cell phone in your race car.
I do.
And then you tweeted from Daytona. Why'd you do that?
I thought it was an incredible experience to see a car hit a jet dryer and create an explosion in the middle of our biggest race of the year. And somehow everybody survived. It was incredible. I feel like I'm going to have that story 40 or 50 years from now. I'm going to have grandkids that look back like, no way, that didn't happen. And I'm going to be like, nope, I got this picture.
On the track, Brad Keselowski is one of NASCAR's most fiery competitors. Off the track, Brad likes to relax by firing off a couple of rounds at a local gun range.
When did you start doing that?
I started shooting about 3 years ago when I got my first rifle.
I'm going to go ahead and hand you the rifle. Let's keep it pointed down range.
Okay.
You go ahead and get in your position that fits you left-handed. There you go.
All right. Do I just press the trigger once?
Yep, just once.
Okay. Did I come anywhere near the rat? Hey, I got him in the leg. All right.
Right there. First shot. You made something happen. I can't. Oh, let me push that one.
Man, you put a hurting on that thing.
That
so stress
me.
Relief.
I feel good. Now I'm ready to win the chase. I have no stress. Maybe I should have had like a 48 target or something.
It's a really powerful feeling.
You feel that fight or flight.
Right, you do.
It's hard to engage that.
Right. And that's what it feels like driving the car?
Oh, absolutely.
Yeah.
Absolutely. I feel like the second I stop fighting, I'm going to be in trouble. Always moving forward.
Next on NASCAR Face-to-Face.
This was kind of just for show. They actually did come in handy a couple times. We had some rowdy guests.
A look at Dale Jr.'s life away from the track and how he's confronted the realities of racing.
Everything's really slow and foggy, and I can't live like this.
And later, Tony Stewart just wants to be loved.
They need a dating site that is about people that are all train wrecks, and I could probably fit right in.
The Dark Knight to the front.
There is going to be a party in Junior Nation.
Three by win is one. Hell yeah.
Driving a hell of a race. Hell of a race.
After 143 races without a win, he's making the donuts on the front straightaway.
Been waiting on that one.
This is Whiskey River, a little western town Dale Earnhardt Jr. built on his property outside Charlotte, North Carolina. Among other things, he likes to celebrate his wins here. And that's something he finally got back to this year after a four-year drought, only to see his hopes for a championship felled by concussions. Like everything else in Junior's life, that got played out in public. But on this day, he shared with us his private thoughts and his own personal world. So this place is amazing. How did you get the idea to do this?
I was building a new house and I wanted to take care of the house. Me and my friends still like to hang out, but I didn't want to do it in my house. So we decided to build something or some kind of place where we could hang out and have some fun. And I'm into Westerns really big and just really love that era, you know, and that mystique. So we wanted to build something. We really didn't expect it to turn out like this.
Now, the first thing I noticed when I came in was that you had an outhouse. So is this actually, you know, is this a working outhouse or?
Well, it is up against the creek bank. So I would say it's partially working.
Right.
So you wouldn't want to do all your.
Oh my gosh.
I came home one time and I had the cockpit of an Indy car hanging out of a tree. My mom texted me and said that she thought the bobsled was pretty cool. And I said, what bobsled are you talking about? And it was actually the cockpit of an Indy car that had been brought in. There'll be all kinds of stuff in all kinds of funny places.
And the jail.
There's two jail cells in there that my uncles built for me. They actually did come in handy a couple times. We had some rowdy guests.
You've actually incarcerated people in here.
Yeah, for their own good, you know, because... you know, some of them late nights, it'd get kind of wild around here.
Your dad loved to have a good time. You just imagine, he probably would have loved this place, huh?
He would have raised Cain with me spending money on something like this, but then he'd go off and tell all his friends how cool it was. So that's the kind of guy he was.
This is it, right?
Yeah,
this
the Silverado it. Saloon is kind of the focal point of the whole town. We had a lot of good parties in there. We got our money's worth out of it.
All right, now, isn't there like a way you're supposed to open a saloon door like you see in the movies, right? They come like crashing in.
Yeah, you just go busting right through the middle.
Right? Let's see how you do it. There you go.
Yeah, just like that.
As the son of a seven-time Cup Series champion, Dale Earnhardt Jr. struggled to deal with growing pains on the track.
I heard you say that when you were younger, there was a time when you crashed and you came home and you were thinking to yourself, this is the end of my career. And you said you and your dad had a great heart-to-heart after that. What did he tell you about putting that in perspective?
Whenever I crashed a car, I went to the lowest of lows. And I'd ran well, but nothing. I hadn't done anything to warrant an opportunity at the next level, which was the Nationwide Series. I was getting this opportunity, knowing full well I really didn't deserve it. And then I went out in like the third or fourth race and wrecked the car in practice before the event. And I thought, you know, in most cases, this is probably the end of, you know, my career as I know it. And so I went home and I was, you know, dad came there and found me. And at first he was very upset and angry that I was, you know, had my head down and was upset. He just said that, you know, my reaction to what happened was wrong. I should have been thinking about how to get back on the racetrack. I should be willing to do anything to get on the racetrack if that's what I want to do for a living. You know, long story short, he said everything was going to work out.
And has that been the attitude that you've had for the better part of your career?
It did change the way I felt. It totally removed a lot of the insecurities I had about, because I was really young and my father was one of the best in the business. You know, everybody just thought he was the greatest thing on earth. And I was trying to figure out how I was going to have a career following that act. You know, I knew I was always going to be kind of compared to him, which I really didn't mind. But I just knew it was going to be tough to really sell people on me. But it did wipe away a lot of the insecurities that I had. And things really kind of took off after that.
Dale Earnhardt Jr. will do his daddy proud as he wins the Coca-Cola 300.
Looks like he's a chip off of Ralph Earnhardt's old block.
Since then, Dale Jr.'s career has included two nationwide championships and 19 wins in Sprint Cup, including the 2004 Daytona 500. Yet at times, some have questioned his dedication to the sport.
There's been that perception in the past. I mean, you've been labeled as, you know, is he not passionate enough about the sport? People have even bandied around the word lazy. Why was that perception out there?
Well, I think that, you know, at times I might have been lazy.
How so?
Yeah, it's just, I don't know, you know, you're in your 20s and you're, you know, we're winning races.
And how about this kid?
That's hero material right there.
We was whooping everybody, and I got paired up with Budweiser, and they wanted me to be myself. I wanted to go out and have fun. That was okay with everybody. And the more fun I had, the better, you know, because we were a perfect match. I thought at the time, you know, that I was working hard. And then when I went to work with Rick, I knew that they did things differently. I knew it was going to be a different culture. I've learned that there's really no limit. There's really no max effort. You know, we work a lot harder now than we did, you know, 5-10 years ago.
Dale Earnhardt Jr. snaps that dry spell winning today at Michigan.
When you won at Michigan, I know you looked for your crew and everybody else. You also kissed your girlfriend, which got caught on camera. So you're letting some of your personal life, I guess, out there. Are you less afraid to let people see those kinds of things now?
Yeah, I guess so. We happened to be winning the race that day, and I wanted her to be in, you know, if that was the case, I wanted her to be in Victor Lane to see what happens and what goes on and be able to enjoy that celebration. That would have been fair at all for her not to have been able to be in that middle of that. So I wasn't uncomfortable with it.
I'm wondering where a family life, as you're in your late 30s now, plays in the picture of what you want for yourself down the road.
I don't have a schedule for that. I think that that's the biggest accomplishment you can have in life is to raise a child, and I'd like to have that experience one day, but I'm definitely want to make sure, you know, the time is right and I can, you know, I can do a good job.
At the white flag, we're on the last lap. Oh, there's contact. Going into the middle of the pack and over.
Everybody piled up.
I just took a lot of hard shots. If this is how we raced every week, I'd find another job.
Dale Earnhardt Jr. is going to miss the next two races due to concussion.
How difficult has it been this year to be what you've said many times, relevant again, to really be at the top, and then to have to really abdicate that because of the concussions?
Yeah, that was really tough. We weren't lying or kidding ourselves to say we had a shot to be in the mix. And then, you know, I had accident at testing in Kansas and didn't feel real good, but I'd been through concussions before and I knew that it would go away eventually. I didn't know how long it'd take. You know, once we had the accident at Talladega and I went to the doctor and I said, you know, something's just not quite right. I don't care about race cars. I don't care about championships, and my head's not feeling right, and I'm worried that I've got to live the rest of my life with this. And if I was to race again and hide it more and have another accident, it could have been pretty tragic. So I'm glad I made the choice I made.
Not just for you, but for someone else too. Because if you're disabled in any way mentally because of a concussion in a sport that's predicated on split-second decisions and reactions, you're putting everybody at risk. How much of that did you think about?
Well, I really, to be honest, I was pretty selfish about it. You know, I was, I hid the first concussion and went to the racetrack and competed. I felt like even at 80%, I was still good enough to do my job.
Were you scared enough that even had you been leading the chase, do you think you would have made the same type of decision?
No, I would never made that. No. If I was leading the chase, I think I would have had a hard time volunteering myself to doctors, for sure. That would have been a totally different situation.
Where does NASCAR have to go with concussions to save drivers, I guess, from themselves, from long-term harm, and for the safety of the sport?
I'm not threatened or worried about anybody putting themselves or anybody else in danger, because I know when it happened to me, nothing else was important anymore. I got to the point to where the only thing I want to do is get this right, because this is annoying me all day long, and I can't live like this, and I don't want to go through any more time than I have to with this going on in my head, you know, and everything's really slow and foggy, and you can't think and process things like you want. It's like a virus running in the background on the computer. You know, I know if any other driver was in that situation, they'd do the same thing I did. I think they would.
Unless they were leading the
Unless
chase.
They were leading the chase. I mean, that's just, you know, everybody's got a price they're willing to pay, I guess.
Dale Jr. is constantly reminded of the realities of racing. They're proudly on display, wrecked cars throughout the woods of his 200-acre property.
Does it have a name? It's like a, I don't know, what is this? What do you call
all
these cars? No, the cars.
Well, this is just the graveyard, the crash car graveyard.
Yeah.
I don't know. Yeah, the NASCAR graveyard, I guess.
Right.
This car right here is the infamous Juan Montoya Daytona car where he ran into the jet dryer. It was an incident that won't soon be forgotten.
I heard the Hall of Fame wanted this car.
The Hall of Fame wanted it, but that went against...
But you got it.
Yeah, that went against my wishes.
So you actually request these cars? Like you'll see something happen and say, hey, what are you doing with the car?
Yeah, I mean, I knew that was a pretty big event. It's pretty cool to have it out here. And some days, you know, 100 years from now, somebody's going to stumble on all this stuff and go, man, what in the world is all this stuff doing out here? This is crazy.
What makes you happiest?
What makes me happiest is winning races, running fast laps, and being around my family and my friends, just spending time with them. The best case scenario for me would be to fill up this saloon and just hang out all night. I mean, that doesn't get any funner than that.
Next on NASCAR Face to Face, Tony Stewart, unfiltered and unapologetic.
Anybody that says we're there for the fans, they're lying. Nobody starts in this sport because of the fans. They start in the sport because they love driving race cars.
They say I'm a bad boy, but you can't have good without bad, I guess.
Oh no, there they go!
I'm ticked right now.
Well, we know what Tony thinks.
I'm not happy, I'm not cordial, I'm not nice.
Tony Stewart wins!
I'm honest, and I speak what's on my mind.
Three-time NASCAR Sprint Cup champion, Tony Stewart wins it!
This is the home of Stewart Haas Racing, winner of the 2011 Sprint Cup Championship, behind owner-driver Tony Stewart. Now, Stewart's a man on the move, so we caught up with him at a photo shoot, which is a far cry from his grassroots. The roots that Tony has clung to through the years in his struggle to stay authentic in the world of big-time racing. This is sort of the part of you that we never see.
Well, this is the part that anybody that thinks that we just show up at the racetrack and drive for 3 days and then we go home and get 4 days off is very, very wrong. This is part of the deal.
When do you ever sit still with your schedule?
That's a really good question.
Such is life for Tony Stewart, who maintains a dual personality in NASCAR as a driver and an owner, since forming Stewart Haas Racing in 2009.
There were a lot of skeptics when you decided to become a team owner. Did you have any trepidation about it?
It was a big leap of faith. It was a, you know, it was like standing on the edge of a cliff, making a decision of, you know, here you had a safety net with a great race team behind me where I was at, or the opportunity to go out on my own. There's nights when I go to bed going, what was I thinking? There's mornings I wake up and go, what was I thinking? But I've never in my life had a feeling like we had at Homestead last year.
This time he's an owner driver. Tony Stewart wins it.
You guys are awesome.
Stewart won his third Sprint Cup championship last year, the latest in a career filled with wins at every imaginable level.
If it has wheels and an engine, you'll race it, right?
Absolutely. Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
Okay, what have you raced? Just take us through the list.
Go-karts, three-quarter midgets, full-size midgets, sprint cars, silver crown cars, wing sprint cars.
Here comes Tony Stewart. He's in a 6'5", he's in a third.
IMCA modified, super modifieds, big block modified, small block modifieds, super late models, crate late models. pavement late models, Truck Series, Nationwide Series, Cup Series, IndyCar.
Is there anything you wouldn't
race? I drove a Formula One car.
Race.
I drove a monster truck.
You've driven a monster truck.
I drove a monster truck once.
Growing up in Columbus, Indiana, Stewart began his career at the age of 7. His father eventually mortgaged the family's home so Tony could race go-karts.
Your dad taught you to not settle for second. How much did he push you?
He pushed like a bulldozer. It wasn't about whether, you know, we obviously wanted to win and always loved winning. But when it came to him dealing with me, I mean, there were races that I won that I still got sat down and had to talk to about, even though we won.
How did you handle losing?
It was just like having a needle jabbing at you. I mean, you just wanted to go the next week that much more and win. And that's the way my whole life's been.
You can see how angry Stewart is because that well could have been his race to win.
You know, I don't like losing. It's always about trying to win.
You seem like a very measured person, a calm person sitting here, a person with a real plan. Well, sitting here.
I'm out of control. Are you kidding me?
Where does that side of you come from, that bad boy,
out of control
side?
That's the passion. I mean, I've always been one that I've always wore my emotions on my shoulder. I don't have much of a filter, and I'm all right with that.
Tony is not happy at the moment.
Come on, man, keep going.
Right away, rookie season, you served notice that temper was going to be front and seven. What was the dynamic there?
I think that was still, I don't think from the time I was a teenager through that period that I was through that reckless stage yet. You know, again, it was, I had a very short fuse and a very short temper. And it didn't go away in a couple years. I mean, it lasted a while.
What you want to do, you know what? You're going to do what I'm going to do. I'll slam you straight in the wall the next time you're anywhere near me.
Hey, you're a bunch of idiots because I was the fastest car on the racetrack at the end.
Go write about something important. Don't waste my time.
The fans were booing you and flipping you off. They didn't like you. You were the villain. To that, did you take home?
A lot. Took it all home, and that was the problem. I got so consumed with and so upset with that it nearly ruined me. It nearly drove me out of the sport. And I got to the point where twice I was ready to hang it up.
When did you first feel that way?
You know, it kind of started when I had that run-in at Martinsville, and you know, it was ironic because shortly after that, Dale Sr. and I were at driver introductions. He put his arm around me and he goes, "Kid, you finally made it." And I'm like, "What do you mean?" He goes, "You went across there. 100% of the people in this place did something, whether they cheered you or whether they booed you. 100% of the people reacted to you. Now you've made it. Anybody that says we're there for the fans, they're lying. Nobody starts in this sport because of the fans. They start in the sport because they love driving race cars."
In 2002, you win your first Sprint Cup championship, and one might think winning is going to alleviate some of that sense of anger or some of that frustration, but it didn't, did it?
No, it's just like when people say that money can't buy everything. It's the same deal. Winning is always a Band-Aid for any problem that you got going on.
That's the same year that you had the infamous incident where you punched a photographer.
I never did connect it, but I swung at him. I mean, there's no doubt about that. And it was actually a guy that I got along with. But I was so frustrated at Indy that year. You know, all I'd ever wanted to do since I was a kid was win at Indy. And we were in a position to do that, and I just didn't want anybody in my face. And he got too close.
At what point did you say to yourself, man, this being
control.
Angry all the time thing is not working anymore?
When it got feeling out of control, it's like, we got to figure something out here. There's more to it than this. I can't hinge my whole life on whether I'm winning races or losing races. This is not an easy sport. Anybody that thinks it's easy, it's ludicrous to think. There's a lot that goes on, and it doesn't matter whether you're, you know, the guys on the bottom of the rung, whether you're Jeff Gordon, Jimmy Johnson, or Dale Jr., everybody has something that they struggle with. And
what do you struggle with the most?
I still struggle with just being me. You know, I can't say I don't understand the celebrity side of it, because I do, but I think I still fight hardest just to be a normal person.
You're so busy. You have so much going on. Do you feel like you have a full life, or is there anything missing?
Well, I would love to say that I've got a wife and a family, but it's probably the one thing in my life that I haven't accomplished, that I want to accomplish.
Are you like a big junk food guy?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, really? Mm-hmm. What's in your refrigerator?
I've got Coke,
okay,
water, and milk. There's a lot of stuff that you either take the lid off or a chip clip off, and that's what's there. Anything else, you have to go out and get it.
Yeah, you're sort of the quintessential bachelor, I must say. Okay, so if you had a profile on a dating website, I don't know, what would...
It'd be like,
it
it'd be like, don't pick me, I'm a train wreck. So they need a dating site that is about people that are all train wrecks, and I could probably fit right in. This is my life. This is what I've done since I was 7 years old, and I don't want to stop. I love this life.
So mama, I'm sure all the hand and I just around.
Yeah. A very special thanks to Jimmy Johnson, Tony Stewart, Brad Keselowski, and Dale Earnhardt Jr. for their honest introspection. And also to their teams for all the time and effort to make these conversations happen during the chase. I hope you enjoyed the show, everybody. We'll see you next time on Face to Face. Mm-hmm.